Hello. Welcome to Loremaster's Lair. I'm your Loremaster, and welcome to the end of 2022. It was a year, but we've got some good tabletop out of it anyway. And let's celebrate the end of the year like I've always do, which second year in a row, I guess. So, always do. A year of the year of the end. End of the year, Errata. I look back at my videos of the past year and of new books we got this past year and do a quick video on my mistakes or new information we have about topics I've already covered. So, quick, messy video. Nothing. Just a short list of topics and me doing this informally, more or less, so. But anyway, first off, we have elves. Elves was one of the first individual ancestry videos I did, so. And Starfinder brought us some more information about them than I originally started with, adding a new branch of the elven family with the Ivaria elves. Ivaria elves are those who broke away from the elf brethren and decided to explore the cosmos instead, visiting planets, living in their culture for a while, then going on a long journey across space that's too slow for anyone but elves to take. So, nice to see. Then we have some more updates on Norgorber. Technically, the Absalom book was out before the end of the year last year, but I apparently missed two things that I should have done erratas on, which are two other branches of Norgorber's worship outside of the main four. The first of them is the Court of Black Papers, which is technically under the Reaper of Reputations branch, but basically what happened was a worshipper of Norgorber thought one day there must be an easier way to rake in all the secrets, and then realized they could do so legally and out in the open by being a lawyer. The Court of Black Paper borderlines on heretical, but most of the other branches respect them for being able to get the job done. The only problem they really have is the Skinscar cult, because the Skinscar cult. And then the other one, briefly mentioned in the Absalom book, just one paragraph in one of the character bios, was the Grey Mask, which is a faith which is a combination of the Grey Master and the Skinscar cult, which basically still all they're interested in is money, but they believe the best way to get it is through ritual killings of the robbery targets. So, next up we have Gorum's divine fighting style. Didn't see it in the divine anthology book, and for some strange reason didn't consider that it might be elsewhere. So yes, it was in the Weapons Master Handbook. But basically, the Gorum swordsmanship basically allows one to use broadswords to do precision vital strikes. And then, as you improve, you get better at using these vital strike feats. So, not that complex, not that strategic. It's just at damage and bloodthirstiness, so perfect for Gorum. Next is Hellknights. This was one that excited me because, again, we have two of the Hellknight branches in Starfinder that we just have the name, well, had. We just had the names of, but nothing else. But the Drift Crisis did give us information on the Order of the Eclipse. So, What the Order of Eclipse specialize in is communications. Whether it be propaganda or whether it be sedition against the local government and stuff like that. Though, of course, with the Drift Crisis still mentioned of focusing more on restoring communications, but mainly their dissenters, the ones who are keeping communications they don't want to happen from going through. The ones that, of course, them being Hell Knights, disrupt the established order. Next up was one from a recent video, my video on the vampires in Pathfinder. Again, it was a toss-up of whether there was a retcon that made Vatala and Vatala Rani the same kind of vampire, or whether they were two distinct different kinds of vampires. But now that we have finished with the Bloodlord Adventure Path, we have a stat block for Canembre. I don't have his name in front of me, so I'm going to pronounce that wrong. But the Bloodlord vampire, and it's confirmed that he has been changed from a Vatala to a Vatala Rana. So, yeah, they've been retconned to be the same thing. Let's see. Now we're getting into the big book of the year, which is a travel guide. The travel guide had so much lore information. I'm definitely going to have to do one video just digging into different topics, seeing what I can find was established of stuff like history or fashion or living kinds of things before that book, and see, make videos on topics like that one of these days. But I have a day job now, so that's gonna be probably more work than I can do in a single week. So, but there's two big things I want to talk about from the book, which first is dates. There was a sneaky retcon which changed the Galarian calendar from 365 and 1/8 days to the 365 and 1/4 days, just like our world. And they did. I don't have it right in front of me. Well, I do have it in front of me. I just don't have the one page that it was mentioned on, but there was a tongue-in-cheek where they acknowledged that that was mentioned, but just had it brushed off like that was something that was in the history and not something that's currently used, which, if retcons are done, I like it to be done like that, to acknowledge what was history, but explain why it isn't now. So, but one thing that I need to spend some time covering is the small one page that we have of all the religious iconography of the different faiths, which, as someone who does a God video once a month and enjoys it, this was definitely, the religion section was definitely my favorite of the Travel's Guide. But this one page, which I currently have pulled up of the religious iconography, just so I could go over that, had to be one of my favorite pages. So let's just quickly look through what we have here to bring up some stuff that didn't exist yet when I made these God videos and I want to mention. Let's see. First up, since we talked about Norgorber, let's mention Norgorber, which is, there's some belief that Tamir Gix, the halfling psychic of Norgorber, is not actually a separate god, but is actually a fifth aspect of Norgorber, which is an interesting religious discourse. Definitely some things you can play around with at your own tables if you use that. Let's see. As money tattoos, nothing too lore-ish about that. Calistria is like labyrinths. I liked seeing that. Now, Estigen cairns. We have the look at some of the more stone giant worship of Aristotle, or Elstic the Hunter, as they call him, as opposed to the majority of the information we have coming from, of course, his human worshippers. So we have the rituals of stacking the five stones to create cairns. That was nice to see. Let's see. Of course, one of the things that stood out to me a lot was the Gazan picks, which, well, the picks themselves were interesting in and of themselves. The thing that was the most interesting was the blurb which mentions that the orphan worship Gazan not as a deity of water and wind, but of ice and fire, which is interesting because, well, mostly they were universally worshipped as I said, wind and water. To see them pick up other elements elsewhere instead of just being the one elemental, well, dual elementals is an interesting change. Makes you wonder what kind of worship we have of these deities outside the Inner Sea region, but we only have outside of the bit we have from 1E about the Tian Sha, we're gonna have to wait a while for some of that probably. Though we know how I am with the in-universe religions, I'm gonna eat that up. Let's see. We have, well, not just the worship of Lamashtu mentioned on this page, but we also had a section that details how even good aligned goblins and orcs and stuff like that still pay some homage to Lamashtu as their mother, even though she is evil, they still have some connections with her. And this short mention of goblins wearing wings to see have connections to their mother is interesting, but the entire thing of good people still paying respects to an evil deity is, well, I'm probably said interesting for most of the things I've already said, but interesting to see that dichotomy and the things you can do with it. And while I haven't talked about Desna, Zonkutan, or Phirasma yet, that leaves the last one that is on this page that I have mentioned before, the Serenite paintings, which the rock paintings on that depict the different animals related to the Dawnflower are, well, it's not all the animals related to Dawnflower, specifically the lizard, which, considering basic iconography having the reptile being the one that's most connected in some areas to a chiefly good deity is a different change of pace, considering how many people feel about snakes and lizards. So, knowing that the Golden Road does respect the lizard is nice to see. But anyway, that was just brief ramblings about, well, mostly this one section of the travel guide for half of it, but just some of the changes that I've seen this year and some of the making up for some of the mistakes I made. So, but that's going to be the end of it. And the end of 2022. Hopefully the next year is even better than this year. So, I say as if this wasn't another year that was chiefly marked by tragedies and dissent, but one day things will be better. Whether it's the peaceful way or the, well, anyway, I'm just rambling. Hope you all enjoy the end of the year, and I hope to see some of you again at the dawn of the next year. Take care, everyone.